A Japanese company has developed a robot able to accomplish complex tasks in the face of high radiation. This robot is needed to decommission reactors at the crippled Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant. Mitsubishi Heavy Industries created the robot. It's built on a platform with tracks on the side. These enable it to move over debris. The robot has two arms that can perform work as complicated as human arms are able to do. The arms can be fitted with various tools to sever and remove broken pipes and rubble. The robot can also cut off parts of concrete walls soaked with radioactive water and examine radiation levels.
The Fukushima plant still has spots where high radiation hampers people from entering. This robot can work in such places.
Mitsubishi engineers say they hope the robot will contribute to a swift decommissioning of the reactor.
Do you know personally of any scientists or engineers that are in the process of developing new technology, robots or otherwise, to deal with Fukushima? And does any of it seem hopeful or promising to you?
Right, okay. No is the answer to that. I think that all of the work that had been done with robots to try and sort out Chernobyl showed that it's impossible to use robots, because the problem is that the electronic systems that robots work on cannot sustain, they cannot function when the radiation fields get too high, because the when radiation impinges on a substance, on any material, what it does is it creates electrons. That's why it's called ionizing radiation. It's absorbed by the material, and it ionizes the material, which means that it kicks electrons out of the material. Now, the problem is that robots work on electrons. Your computer works on electrons. All of these chips, all the electronic chips that people use all work on electrons. I mean, you can't have a system where the electrons are just randomly being kicked out all over the place, because ultimately the whole thing gets scrambled, and that's what they found in Chernobyl. And they tried everything. They tried the Germans had some very fancy robots, and then they tried robots from somewhere else, and they built their own robots, and none of the robots worked. They worked up to the point where they got into the high radiation fields, and then they just went mad, went around in circles, and sort of fell off the side. That's why in the end, in Chernobyl, they had to send men in. They called them bio-robots, and they just called up 20,000 men from the reserve army list. And they put roofing lead around them and sent them in to pick up this stuff by their bare hands and throw it over the side. And, of course, they all died. You won't hear that. I mean, the international nuclear industry says that nobody really died after Chernobyl except a few of the firemen right at the beginning. But there's an enormous number of people who died because the Russians sent in these young men. And the young men just got huge radiation effects, and then they mostly died before they were 40. Terrifying. But this can't happen in Japan, and the robots won't work. So as I say, there's nothing you can do. They just have to dig around it, isolate it, put up a big notice saying mankind's folly, and keep it cool for another 1,000 years or however long it is.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, well, you say there's no solution to the waste, but there is a solution to the waste, and the solution to the waste is to just leave it exactly where it is and to have somebody look at it for a million years, you know? So they just have to have all these zombies who are there at the moment, sitting there doing nothing, who are going to just have to sit there, and their children are going to sit there, and their children's children and so on, looking at the waste and making sure that it doesn't leak out of the tanks. And if it starts to look like it's going to leak out of the tanks, they build another tank around that tank, and then they build another tank around the tank that they built around that tank, and so on, you know, to infinity. And that is a solution to the waste, because then the waste will just stay where it is now, and it won't get any worse. And if they make more waste, they'll have to put it inside that tank and leave it there. And as far as contaminated land is concerned, and places like Sellafield and all that, they'll just have to put a fence around it and say, this is contaminated land, do not enter. And so that's the best we can do. I mean, it doesn't help to put it down the hole in the ground. I mean, you may as well put it somewhere where you can keep an eye on it and make sure it doesn't escape. So that's the solution.
And why not put a hole in the ground
Ah, well, because then if something goes wrong, you can't do anything about it. That's the point.
And what could be could go wrong there?
Well, God, well, loads of things could go wrong. I mean, the main thing that would go wrong is that it's a hole in the ground is not a secured depository, you know? I mean, you put it into a hole in the ground, and then there's a crack in the hole in the ground, or maybe there's an earthquake, or maybe there's a fault that you didn't know about, or maybe there's some water movement that changes over a period of time. And we're talking geological timescales, so, you know, just about everywhere where they've suggested putting it in a hole in the ground has had a geological fault occurring, you know, in the last 1,000 years, never mind about, you know, the next 1,000,000 years, or whatever it is it has for the half-life of these uraniums and plutoniums. So you can't actually guarantee that if you put it in a hole in the ground, something won't go wrong. And you can't pull it out of the hole in the ground, that's the point. I mean, the Forsmark idea is not one in which they put it down in the hole in the ground and then they can take it out if something goes wrong. They can't. They just pop it down and pop the next one down and pop the next one down and so on and send it all down there and then they seal it all up. But if something goes wrong, then they can't do anything. Whereas if it's where it is at the moment, at Sellafield or wherever it is, above ground or in some kind of big hangar or big kind of area where they kind of look at it, then they can look at it. And if something goes wrong, they've got all their detectors and their Geiger counters and whatnot, then they can just repackage it and put something around it.
But they have to sit there.
Yeah, they have to sit there forever. Absolutely, yeah, sure. Well, it serves them right, isn't it? Shouldn't have made it in the first place. And I've no doubt they'll pay them a lot of money for sitting there. So yeah, they can sit there. I mean, maybe they should have special uniforms, like, you know, guard of the nuclear waste, and they could have like special kind of green uniforms with special badges, like Superman or something, you know. That'd make them feel good. I've always thought it quite good to have special uniforms. In all the science fiction stories, they did special uniforms, you know. So you could say, what's your daddy do? Oh, he's a guard of the nuclear waste. Oh, no. What a useful job, George. Yes, it is. Isn't it?